Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, whose forgiveness is sure and whose steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Together, let us honestly and humbly confess that we have not lived as God desires. Loving and forgiving God, we confess that we are held captive by sin. In spite of our best efforts, we have gone astray. We have not welcomed the stranger. We have not loved our neighbor. We have not been Christ to one another. Restore us, O God. Wake us up and turn us from our sin. Renew us each day in the light of Christ. Amen. People of God, hear this glad news. By God's endless grace, your sins are forgiven and you are free. Free from all that holds you back and free to live in the peaceable realm of God. May you be strengthened in God's love, comforted by Christ's peace, and accompanied with the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. Let us pray. Stir up your power, Lord Christ, and come. With your abundant grace and might, free us from the sin that would obstruct your mercy, that willingly we may bear your redeeming love to all the world. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe. In your Son, Emmanuel, you have shown us the light and saved us from the power of sin. Bless us as we light the candles of this wreath. Increase our longing for your presence, that at your celebration of your Son's birth, his Spirit might dwell anew in our midst. For he is our light and salvation. Blessed be God forever. Amen.
The first reading is from 2 Samuel, chapter 7. A reading from 2 Samuel. Now, when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day, but I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I look for you from the pasture, from following the sheep to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and I will plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. The evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. Your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The responsive reading is from Luke, the first chapter. "My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. For you, Lord, have looked with favor on your lowly servant. From this day, all generations will call me blessed. You, the Almighty, have done great things for me, and holy is your name. You have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You have shown strength with your arm and scattered the proud in their conceit, casting down the mighty from their thrones and lifting up the lowly. You have filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. You have come to the aid of your servant Israel to remember the promise of mercy, the promise made to our forebears, to Abraham and his children forever.
The second reading is from Romans, the 16th chapter. Paul closes his letter to the Romans by praising God because in the proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ, God has revealed the promised divine plan of salvation for all humanity. Paul proclaims this gospel of Christ in order to bring about the obedience of faith among all nations. A reading from Romans. Now to God, who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but is now disclosed, and through the prophetic writings is made known to all the Gentiles, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever. Amen. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I'm a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Now, I'm sure you know Mary, but do you remember Miriam? It would be understandable if you didn't. We mostly talk about Miriam's little brother, Moses. When Moses was a baby, his mother and his sister together conspired to hide him in a basket by the river. And so his life was saved. It's a great story. God saved little baby Moses, who went on to do great things. But of course, we know God likes to work through people. And in this case, one of the people that God worked through was the baby's big sister, Miriam. She's the one who watched to make sure that he stayed safe. When Pharaoh's daughter came along and wanted to adopt the baby, Miriam was the one who said, "I know someone who can help you take care of him." So because of her, Moses' own mother got to raise him. And later, when he grew up and he led God's people out of slavery into freedom in their own country, Miriam was right there with him the whole time. She wasn't just the sister of somebody famous. She was a prophet and a leader in her own right. She led and probably wrote the song of praise that the people sang when they safely crossed the Red Sea, some of the oldest recorded words in our Bible. Many years later, the people were in a different kind of trouble. This time they were living in their own land, but it was occupied by a foreign power, the Roman Empire. Their own leaders were more interested in protecting themselves than in helping the people they were supposed to serve. But still, the ordinary people hoped and prayed that God would send the Messiah. They longed for God to come and set them free, as in the days of Moses. So they named their daughters after Miriam. In Greek, it sounds more like Mariam. In English, we would say Maria or Mary. That's right, Mary is named after Miriam. Naming your daughter for Miriam was partly an act of hope. Hope that, like Miriam, she would witness the salvation of her people. It was partly an act of prayer. "Please, God, give my daughter the courage and the faith of her namesake." And it was partly an act of defiance. The Romans might laugh. "Every other woman or girl is named Mary, huh?" But the people knew that the God of Miriam and Moses was also the God of every single woman and girl named Mary. And when that God decides to take action, then woe to those who stand in the way. So who's going to get the last laugh? And then one day God sends the angel Gabriel to a young woman named Mary. Despite some vague connection to the house of David, she's nobody very special. She's just another Mary. But don't count her out because of that. Like her namesake, she has her own thoughts, her own voice. She has heard the history and the scriptures of her people her whole life long. She knows what God has done in the past. She knows what God has promised to do in the future. She knows that for that to happen, something pretty dramatic is going to have to take place. Most people, when they see an angel, are immediately overwhelmed with fear. That's why angels always start by saying, "Don't be afraid." But Mary, she is a little scared and confused and troubled, but she's also thoughtful. She questions what she doesn't understand. And instead of just telling her to do what she's told, the angel answers her questions. And when she begins to grasp that this is it, this is God acting, this is how it begins, Mary knows that she wants in. And so Mary named for Miriam, conspires with God to save the world. God could have done it however God wanted. God didn't have to involve a human co-conspirator. But this is how God chose to do it, because God loves to work through people. And in this case, the person is Mary. Her courage and thoughtfulness and faith are vital to God's plan. She will ensure that God's son is born into the world. I don't know how much of that she understood right away, but by the time she got to meet her relative Elizabeth, Mary was ready to compose and sing her own song of praise. It's a powerful song, revealing her to be a prophet, a preacher, a leader in her own right. Mary proclaims the good news that God is acting in the world right now through her. Through her! A God who would work through Mary is a God to be reckoned with. That's the God who is stepping into the world to set things right. That's the God who is casting down the powerful who abuse their power. That's the God who is lifting up the lowly. That's the God who is filling the hungry with good food and sending away empty those who chose not to share. That is the God who will ultimately save the world, not through military might or political conquest, but on a cross. Today, again, as always, God's people long for God to come and set us free. Like Mary, we know the stories of what God has done in the past. Like Mary, we know what God has promised to do in the future. When things are going well and we're pretty comfortable, maybe we're okay with waiting. But this is 2020 and we are tired of waiting. We long for God to take action now. Something pretty dramatic is obviously needed. And the God of Miriam, Mary, and Jesus can be counted on for that. But remember, that God likes to work through people. And in this case, the people are us. After all, not many of us are named after Mary, but all of us are named after the King, the Messiah, the Christ. All of us who are baptized in his name and called Christian are the heirs of Miriam, Mary, and Jesus, the Christ. God has promised to set all things right, and God will do that in God's own time, with or without us. But God is also conspiring with us to make God's reign a reality here and now. That's who we are, and even more, that is who this God of ours is. So in Jesus' name, all God's people always will say, Amen.
Oh, With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always, and also with you. Generous God, you have created all that is, and you provide for us in every season. Bless all that we offer, that through these gifts, the world will receive your blessing. In the name of Jesus, Emmanuel, we pray. Amen. Let us pray. God of power and might, tear open the heavens, and come quickly to this weary world. Hear our prayers for everyone in need. Gracious God, all generations call you blessed. In this holy season, we pray for our neighbors of our other denominations and faiths. Inspire the faith of their people. Cultivate understanding among us and strengthen us in this love of service to our community. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Creator God, you scatter the proud, everything we have belongs first to you. Bless and protect the seas, mountains, plains, forests, skies, and soils that surround us. Give us humility as we tend to them. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Righteous God, you humble the powerful and lift up the lowly. We pray for the leaders of all nations, and they amplify the voice of people in need. Guide all people entrusted with leadership to create societies in which everyone can flourish. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Compassionate God, you fill the hungry with good things and you send the rich away empty. Nourish those who lack access to adequate food and nutrition. Bless the work of advocates, community organizers, the food pantries. Encourage others to provide for their neighbors in need. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Healing God, you pour out mercy to all who cry out to you. Surround everyone in need of healing in body, mind, or spirit with your tender presence, especially the homebound. Ray, Christine, Pat, Maybeth, Marilyn, Mary Lou, Joan, Marge. And we pray for Alfred, Rick, Beth, Judy, for all who are facing coronavirus, those who are receiving care from Stephen ministers, and those we now name silently or aloud. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We rejoice in the baptismal anniversaries of Tori Soy and Chuck Soy. We thank you for the youth of the congregation and the community, especially today, for Ariel Langer. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Eternal God, you are faithful to the promise you made to our forebears. We give you thanks for the ministry of Katharina von Bora Luther and other ancestors who organized, planned, dreamed, encouraged, and reached out as they served you. We give thanks for the holy leadership of female leaders in our own time. Inspire others with their steadfast witness. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Draw near to us, O God, and receive our prayers. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O God of justice and love, we give thanks to you that illumine our way through the life of the words of your Son. Give us the light we need, awaken us to the needs of others, and at the end bring all that the world to your feast. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen.
For Christmas Eve this year, we are working on a special service with some other ELCA Lutheran congregations in our area and with some of our ministry partners. I think you'll be pleased to find out who some of them are. And of course, there are also plenty of contributions from us here in Vermilion. That service will be available as usual on YouTube for you to watch when you like. Since it is a special occasion, though, we're also going to try showing it as something called a premiere on our Facebook page at 7 p.m. If you have a Facebook account, you can watch that video and you can interact live with other people who are watching at the same time, including me. If you don't have an account, it's fine. You can still watch the video and you can still see how other people are responding. And then after it shows the first time, it'll be available for you to go back and watch at any time after that, just like on YouTube. Just something we're going to try out. Then Sunday, December 27th, we'll be back to a regular Sunday schedule, except we will have lessons and carols for Christmas, so you'll have more opportunities to sing along at home. Of course, you can still give through ELCA good gifts, and you can still donate hats and mittens using the drop box that's outside the front door at church. As always, you can get more information about any of these announcements in your email newsletter. If you don't get the email newsletter, you can sign up at trinityvermilion.org. Now, may the creator of the stars bless your Advent waiting. The long-expected Savior fill you with love. The unexpected Spirit guide your journey, now and forever. Amen.
Go in peace, prepare the way of the Lord. Thanks be to God.